Alleluia, alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed, alleluia.
We get to say it for a little while longer. I am really honored to be able to be with you and talk with you about this task that we have been given of preaching the word. I confess, I've been worried. When I first came to the International Center, I got a phone call from Dr. Carl Barth. How many of you guys remember Dr. Barth? Some of you. He was the president of Concordia Seminary in St. Louis for a long time. Always the joke was Dr. Carl Barth, not the theologian. He never thought it was very funny. But he said, when he heard that I had taken the call to be a director of worship, he said, Bill, I'm really happy for you on that. It's really great. We got things we need to work on with the liturgy, but what really is tearing my heart out is what I see happening with our preaching. And I was kind of surprised that he put it out that bluntly. But then I said, you know what? I actually agree, and I don't think that in the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod we actually have a problem with the liturgy. I believe that what we have is a problem with our preaching, and I fully believe that when the preaching is remedied, the liturgy just takes care of itself. That's a pattern that happened at the Reformation, right? It started in the pulpit. It started with what was preached. And when what was preached was that beautiful, pure word of God, the stuff in the worship service that didn't fit very well began to be more and more uncomfortable and painful until it finally was removed, went away. And what was left was all that which was congruent with the preaching. If that's the case, the liturgy mess up is like the canary in the coal mine, warning us of something far more serious and more at the heart of what Christ sent us to do. Zasa said, if we're going to have renewal inside of the church, it has to start with the office of preaching. This is where we must focus our attention. And I hope that our time together will allow us to do that. So I want to begin by literally throwing out the question. Do you guys agree? Do you think that there actually is a problem in preaching? I know you guys don't usually get to hear it, right? You're usually doing it. But do we have a problem with preaching, do you think? I see some yes. I remember I said this to Swirla, and Swirla's like, oh, you bureaucrats, you always dream up this stuff. You dream up crises for us. And it's like, I actually think it, I'm not dreaming it up. I actually think it's out there. What's its nature? What do you think has gone wrong with our preaching? I'm asking seriously. Anybody want to offer a thought or two? Yeah.
I got a letter that said I was too biblical on Sunday morning.
Too biblical. Okay, this touches at the very heart of so much of what's gone on around us. We're called to speak a word out from the word on the basis of the word, but it's a word that is no longer in the memories of most of our people. When you say David, they don't bring a host of stories with them in their minds. When you say Mephibosheth, it's hopeless. Why? Why? I want to float out an idea that you guys are going to all get mad at me for, especially my dear brother, Dr. Starbush. Don't get mad at me. I honestly think that what happened with our people's biblical knowledge happened in the 1960s and 70s. Anybody take a guess what I'm talking about? We shifted without discussing or thinking about it overnight to a brand new lectionary. And the three-year lectionary has so much that's strong about it. Don't get me wrong, there's a lot of strength to it. But it does have a weakness. And the weakness is that it doesn't repeat the stuff every year. It doesn't take a set of biblical stories and screw them down into the people's memory year by year by year by year, so that when it's all said and done, there's a set of 70, 78, whatever Bible stories that they know like that, because they hear them. And if they miss a Sunday, they don't have to wait a decade for the reading to come back. Because what if they missed it that next time too? Right? It could easily happen. I really do, and let me add with that, when we shifted our lectionary, we also initiated a crisis of music. Because our music had been written around that smaller set of readings. So I think the question of when they say it's too biblical, they're probably at the point of it might be right. I get the same complaint. And I think the only way we can answer it is to have our people again learn the word. I'm going to go further, though. I think our pastors are not as familiar with the scriptures as they once were. Have you wrestled with who killed Goliath? You know what I'm talking about? What am I talking about?
Is it reference in Kings, is it, or later in Samuel?
It's 2 Samuel.
Is it someone else who's named?
Somebody else killed Goliath. And then Chronicles gives it to you with, oh, now that guy killed the brother of Goliath. But if you didn't know that, why? Because we're not living in the Word the way that our fathers in the faith lived in the Word, right? One of the best ways, the absolute best ways, for you to live in the Word and let it totally impact you in a way that it never will any other way. Audible. Download it, the scriptures, listen. Don't listen to these, you know, when you study, you work on a little bit at a time. Don't do that. Listen. Listen from start to finish. And you hear things there that you had never had to wrestle with before. And that is a huge blessing. And then the people will say, wow, he's even getting more biblical on us. This won't be a problem. The people of God actually hunger for the Word of God. They just don't hunger for a lot of our cliches about the Word of God. I want this to be a total conversation, so anytime you want to say something, you can feel free. Speak. I see it on your face. Yeah, I want to.
I understand your comments in the lectionary, but I don't think you're right that it was the move to the three-year lectionary. I think the three-year lectionary in many ways saved us because two things. First of all, the historic lectionary that was being used did not include the Old Testament.
Right.
So they weren't hearing the Old Testament.
Right.
Second of all, by the 60s, they were in many cases reading the old lectionary, but they were not preaching on it.
Yeah, we certainly had a lot of that. Right, they were growing.
There was a reason
Sure, they'd already gotten bored with those passages of scripture, which might invite our thought. What right do we have to be bored with the word? But
the crisis was already there.
I'm not going to disagree with you, and I just think that you cannot deny the pedagogical value of it, especially if you fix the 1 year like we have by said, well, there's no reason we can't have an Old Testament reading just like they have in the 3 year. And then we have another set of readings that we're screwing down into the people's memory year by year by year. You know, take it or leave it. That may, I'm just curious. Anybody in this room has preached the 1 year repeatedly? Anyone? Okay, we have a pile of you guys that have. Tell me this. Do you get bored preaching the 1 year lectionary? Do your people actually seem to know the stories pretty well? Some?
They're learning.
I'll never forget Dr. Maxwell at Maryville. He called me up. He said, I had the weirdest experience in church this morning. I was like, what? He said, this lady walked in and she pulled out the bulletin and she exclaimed aloud, oh, it's O Jerusalem that weepeth Sunday. Because on the 10th Sunday of Trinity every year, you read about the destruction, or Jesus' prophecy of the destruction of Jerusalem. And we actually had a hymn in our hymnal that was designed to be used on that day for that occasion. And the people, she had it down. And she welcomed it with joy, the same way you welcome with joy when Easter comes or Christmas comes. And you know, the songs are the ones you expect that will help proclaim those readings. Biblical knowledge, I think that is a problem. I think our people are truly suffering for lack of it. They don't know the stories. And I think we as pastors have tended to simply give lip service to the doctrine about scripture, its inspiration, its inerrancy. But we haven't actually taken the time, if these things are true, which they are, to actually ingest this word with all of the things that will make you scratch your head and go, huh? Where is this headed? Yeah.
I'm just surprised with the interaction that we haven't gotten around to the issue of culture.
Culture.
In a mass media age where people get hundreds of hours of television, look at the time it took to go from homosexuality was evil to you're evil if you don't jump on the transgender bandwagon. And that is all driven by media input. And you have all of that cultural input that the lay people are getting, which is very, if you did give a biblical sermon, it's not going to ring true with what they heard on the sitcom on Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday. And you've got that factor.
Yeah.
And coming out of American evangelicalism, my experience was that the American evangelical message was very simpatico with the culture. So it was just like going to a rock concert, it was just like going to a movie, it was just like going to a sporting event with a prayer attached. And so all of the preaching style, preaching content addresses that consumer-driven reality. So if you come into a Lutheran church, it's gonna seem really weird.
It's gonna seem really out of step. Totally out of step. And the more biblical, the more out of step it's going to be. But I really think the point you're making about the catechesis that the culture does, the church cannot combat that catechesis with the old methods. If you think that you're going to keep the kids in the church by having them have 1 hour of confirmation instruction for even 3 years, when the rest of their time is spent with this new media, I think you need to wake up. It's not going to happen. It's a far more serious fight than that. And let's be clear, it is a fight, right? Because not only has the cultural the media itself swept through, you have the total collapse of any support in the culture itself. In fact, war against it to the point that what's Sunday morning for? If you have a kid, what is Sunday morning for? Soccer, sports. I mean, you're, and what do you mean that I shouldn't be out there with my, I can't deprive my kid. Have you ever had trouble getting your kids to church because of this? I mean, it's a real thing. And to say to a parent, no, you need to make a decision here about your child's own spiritual, eternal welfare. What are you going to do? It becomes a real challenge. Yeah, John.
Yeah, I think it was Dr. Suckwish, only because of his soft-spoken nature out there that I couldn't hear. But I think your 1 year to 3 year and his observation, the point is that time frame introduced that in a crisis that has so many headed, that it's hard to get your head around all of the pieces of that.
It is.
Mm-hmm. Not music styles different. I'm talking about the true in the Lutheran tradition in writing.
Yeah.
At the same time that we were introducing all sorts of really weird stuff that didn't support Lutheran doctrine into the music. So it's just that the crises was so multifaceted, it's hard to lay it at the feet of any one piece, although not knowing the stories of the scriptures is, I would agree with you on that. It's true. But there's lots of.
Yeah, and I absolutely agree with everything you just said there. It is a multifaceted beast. I do think that it's important to recognize, though, the pedagogical power of repetition. That when something is done again and again and again and again, it has the ability to write it deep into people's minds and hearts. The pericopes, I heard a fellow describe it like this a couple weeks ago, and I thought it was brilliant. He says, the pericopes become icons. In the people's head, they have a picture of what happened. If I said Jesus riding into Jerusalem, you've got a picture already, right? It's become a picture. That's how the old pericopal system did. Yeah?
Another piece.
Yeah. Of a piece with this, I really want to stress the Lutheran Ordo was intended to be scripture rich because the songs themselves are all scripture and the hymns are but reflections on the scripture, and there's always space for the reading of the Word of God. I don't know about you, but I'm always struck when we read Justin and he said, the writings of the apostles or the prophets are read for as long as time permits. They were a people who came to hear the Word and they didn't mind spending time listening. But we're not a people who are used to spending time listening anymore. So that's a huge challenge. Yeah.
Do you find that there's a difference between congregations that have a Lutheran elementary school connected to them, or even a Lutheran high school, where those young people are exposed to God's Word throughout the week, parents also are involved with their children's homework, and so these stories are reviewed for them, as opposed to churches where the children don't have that opportunity?
The difference in my own experience is night and day. As much as I want to believe that a homeschooling parent will get those stories into the kids the same way, I dealt with this as a pastor for a long time. I had some homeschool kids, some went to public school, but their parents were really faithful about teaching them. They couldn't come close during the public examination. I mean, I always had to rely on the kids from the parochial school because they had it down pat. So I think that, again, repetition and exposure is huge. And really valuable. It sets a culture for them to actually be able to hear the Word. Yeah.
I said, attendant on removing the scripture is also a music problem where, and I've seen this too, where we've got, you know,
I think we need to be clear that when we've substituted the liturgy of the Pentecostals for the liturgy of the Lutherans, we've done a disservice to ourselves. Our liturgy truly is rich, and the hymnody of our church is so wonderfully weighty that I always say, if a pastor hasn't taught his people this or that hymn, it's spiritual malfeasance on his part. Think about it. Should anybody... What is your number one big evangelism opportunity in your church? What is it? It's the funeral service. You get all these people that never darken the door of a church. They're there. And what do you do? Do you sing Amazing Grace? Really? How great thou art? Really? I mean, think about it. Think about what a witness it is. If we walk out of that church with that coffin singing, "Death, you cannot end my gladness. I am baptized into Christ. When I die, I leave all sadness to inherit paradise. Though I lie in dust and ashes, faith assurance brightly flashes. Baptism has the strength divine to make life immortal mine." You offer that, and people who are on the outside, they set up and take notice. I've told this story before, so if you've heard me tell that, I beg your forgiveness. But I had a friend named Charlie. He was like my best buddy. We play racquetball all the time. He beat the crap out of me all the time. But I loved him. He was one of these bouncy guys, you know what I mean? He was just filled with the joy of life. One day, the ambulance driver calls his pastor, "You better get to the hospital because this one is going to have an ugly ending." And I was like, "No. Oh, no." Charlie had sat home thinking he had a cold all day long. He was having a heart failure. And so he's gone. And his kids, I had to tell his wife, his kids. And it was about 3 a.m. on a Sunday morning when I finally got back home. Early service at St. Paul's, 7:45. I walk out there at 7:45 with a very, 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 very heavy heart. And I look there, and they're all there! And they said, "Well, Pastor, we could not be with where Dad wasn't today. If you're having the Lord's Supper, we'll be with the saints in glory, and we'll be there with him. We're here." So I tell his wife, "Lola, I'm sorry, you can't plan the funeral. You see, Charlie has written me every detail. I can show you the emails." She goes, "No, I trust you. Just go do what he said." So we did Charlie's funeral as this massive celebration of joy and in your face, Satan. Charlie was a businessman who had connections to a certain city in the north part of Illinois. And he was in liquor. And some of his connections were less than savory. Vinny showed up to the funeral. We'd heard stories about Vinny for a long time, but here he is at the funeral. And he walks out and he goes, "I don't get it. I don't get it. What is the matter with you people? It's like you were happy or something." And we got tears streaming down our face, and we're like, "We are. We are. Death has not won." What do we sing? "In peace and joy I now depart." He insisted on that one. What did we sing? "God's own child, I gladly say it." What did the choir sing? Take a guess. Hallelujah chorus. He'd been a big singer, so people that had sung in different choirs all around, they came and joined in, and we just belted it out. And it was joy. It was overflowing joy. And everything about the funeral testified to the people that did not know anything about our church that we really believe that Jesus Christ has defeated death, and that we really believe that love will be the final word of this world. It is the final word. And we live toward that reality. Our preaching confesses it. Our music confesses it. Our liturgy confesses it. And we really have a lot better to offer than to pull out leftover I don't mean this to be insulting, leftover Baptist music. Do you know what I mean? We just have a very, very, very rich heritage. Now, having said that, it is certainly possible for us to have earned the reputation we've received. I never really knew how this was till choir director that community chorus we're in, he's saying, don't sing it like the Lutherans. I was like, what? and then I found out what he meant. How do we sing? Well, let's just say that the joy of the Lord overflowing many times does not come through. It should, if you look at what you're singing. But there are times that we can take anything and turn it into a funeral dirge. But when we let the music be what it is, and we have our preaching be a lifting up of the great surprise that's Christ, more on that in a second, then I really do think people encountering what we have to offer are truly drawn in. We have something that is a gem, that when it is offered, I did not grow up in the Lutheran church. Any of you guys not like me, non-cradles, not a cradle Lutheran? Raise your hand if you're not cradle Lutheran. Okay, those of you who come in from the outside. We sometimes get very impatient with you because it seems to us that you don't realize what you've got. So many times in the preaching, in the teaching, in the singing, in the liturgy. What you got is so rich to offer. My classic example is that the Baptists are very excited about the blood. Sing it with me. There is power, power, wonder working power. Can't you sing it? You don't know that song? In the blood of the Lamb, there is power, 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 wonder working power. They're all excited about it. But if you say to them, great, where's the blood? What's their answer? Huh? Well, if it has wonder working power, where can I find it? Where can it come to me? Well, you gotta pray. But how do I get it? Well, I don't know. Your question doesn't make sense. Now, the Lutherans, on the other hand, they know where the blood is. They know exactly where it is. When you read the New Testament and you read about the blood of Jesus that blots out the sin of the world, I sure hope you're not thinking about some imaginary blood. You're thinking about what's in the chalice and poured down your throat. I remember having a vicar whose name was Brian. He was like built like a football player. And I walk in the sacristy one day and he is just giggling. This big guy. And he's giggling. I was like, what is the matter with you? And he said, I have the best job in all the world. I get to pour eternal life down people's throats. How sweet is that? And I thought, ordain him. That is a man who gets the joy of what a pastor is called to do and to be. If the Baptists are all excited about the blood but don't know where it's found, we Lutherans should be ever more excited because we know exactly where it's found. And we have songs that celebrate it with every bit as much joy. What's the greatest one? I think. At the Lamb's high feast we sing praise to our victorious King who has washed us in the tide flowing from his pierced side. How do you guys sing it? I'm curious. What tempo? Sing, praise. Is that about normal? I confess that I tend to be a little spastic. So my favorite version of it actually runs, at the Lamb's high feast we sing praise to our victorious King who has washed us in the tide flowing from his pierced side. Alleluia. I think it actually has people sit up and take more notice. There's a whole bunch of our music that we could do that for. Don't tell John Vicker I said that. We were. Any of you guys have Slovak background?
No.
So, okay. So the Slovak Lutherans, I mean, they are a wonderful people unto themselves. And their music, unbelievable. So I purposefully chose that we would do their, you know what their number one Christmas song is? It's Chastrodosti. I can never remember how it goes in our new hymnal. It used to go, come rejoicing, praises voicing, Christmas day is breaking. But as the Slovaks sing this, they would sing, Chastrodosti veselosti svado nastalnini. I mean, it just flowed. So we'd sing it at the IC, and I almost, in fact, I at the devotion that day, I said, we have to sing this again, because what we had was, come rejoicing, praises voicing, Christmas day is breaking. From a musician who I respect so very, very much, but no. Other thoughts before we move on? I mean, I have stuff that I actually want to get to, but I wanted to give you guys the chance to bring up some of the stuff that was a problem with preaching, and you certainly brought up a lot. I'm sorry.
That's the gospel, and so turn to the law.
Oh, at the end.
Try to motivate something, get something out of our people.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I always tell people, never underestimate the power of the law to get the job done in the short term. If what you need is to get people to turn out on Sunday morning for a given event, you can lay the law on them, and it usually works once or twice, all right? But to have the true lasting effect of the law, it just can't be that, what did Dr. Corby call it? That he says it gums you to death, all the teeth taken out of it. I want to turn, I want to turn to some scripture. Do you guys have your Bibles with you, or can you access them on your devices? Speaking of modern times. I want to start with Isaiah 40. Isaiah 40. And in Isaiah 40, turn to verse 6. I actually don't agree with how this has been translated, so we'll work our way through it. It starts out with what? A voice says, cry. In other words, a voice says, go preach. And what is what's the response? And he says, what on earth do you expect me to preach? Why? Because all flesh is grass, and all of its beauty, all of it, is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades when the spirit breath of Yahweh blows on it. Surely the people are grass. What's he saying? Thank you. What's he saying? What good news do I have to give? Everybody's dying. Nothing is going to last. What am I supposed to tell these people? And that's why I think the next little bit is actually the voice answering. And I think the voice says back, the grass withers, yes. The flower fades, yes. But the davar Eloheinu, it's to the ages. Where everything else fails and falls, there is something which lasts. And that something is the word of Yahweh. And when you hear word there, I hope you're hearing it just the way you sang it in the divine service. Word of God come down from heaven. This is the word that endures forever, having become grass that withers and flower that fades, and yet he lives. Because of this, the explosion of joy at verse 9. So get you up, to a high mountain, Zion, herald of good news. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good news. Lift it up, don't be afraid. Say to the cities of Judah, look, there's your God, the word of the Lord that endures. Look, there's your God. He comes with might. His arm rules for him. His reward is with him. His recompense before him. And he will tend his flock like a shepherd. He'll gather the lambs in his arm. He'll carry them in his bosom. And he will gently lead those that are with young. What on earth should I preach? Preach this, the word of Yahweh, the word of the Lord that endures forever. I want to move to a passage in the New Testament that directly impinges on preaching. Look at Mark 16. Don't get me started on whether or not the longer ending of Mark is canonical. The church has given it to you as a gift. Receive it with joy. Mark 16. And in Mark 16, what do you have Jesus telling the disciples? Verse 15. What do we got there? Who's got it? Read it out. Stop. I used to think that was it. It stopped. Go preach the gospel to the whole creation. And then he added an addendum.
Yes. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned.
Was I hearing it right? No. I was totally missing what he was saying. When he said, go preach the good news to the whole creation, he then tells them what the good news is. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. Whoever does not believe will be condemned. This is the good news that he sends out into all creation. And if you think I'm crazy, turn to Acts 8. Look at Acts 8. Acts 8, and we're going to pick up with the Ethiopian eunuch story. Acts 8. Verse 26. Now an angel of the Lord said to Philip, rise, go to the south, to the road that goes from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a desert place. And he rose and went. And there was an Ethiopian, a eunuch, a court official of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, put in charge of all her treasury, which means he was probably pretty wealthy. He had come to Jerusalem to worship and was returning, seated in his chariot, and he was reading the prophet Isaiah. And the Spirit said to Philip, go over and join this chariot. So Philip ran to him and heard him reading Isaiah the prophet and asked, do you understand what you're reading? He said, how can I unless someone guides me? And he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. Now, the passage he was reading was this. Like a sheep, he was led to the slaughter. Like a lamb, before its shears is silent, so he opens not his mouth. In his humiliation, justice was denied him. Who can describe his generation? His life is taken away from the earth. And the eunuch said to Philip, about whom, I ask you, does the prophet say this? About himself or about someone else? Then Philip opened his mouth. And beginning with this scripture, he told him the good news about Jesus. Now look at this. Look at this. And as they were going along the road, they came to some water. And the eunuch said, look, there's water. What prevents me from being baptized? What does that tell you about how Philip preached Isaiah 53 to the eunuch. What does it tell you he did? He preached baptism. He preached the promise of baptism. Everything that he's doing here for you by taking your sins, he puts it for you in this water. And when you get in the water with him, where his name is, all of that comes over to you. All of it becomes yours. So naturally, as soon as he sees the water, he's like, stop, stop. What prevents me from being baptized? And into the water they go. The Western text tradition has an interesting variation there too. We'll let that one go. So, when the apostles preached, they most often began with an Old Testament text. And from that text, they proclaimed Jesus as the fulfillment of the text. And they never stopped the sermon until the good news of where the blessings that they just described could be found. They didn't just talk about the power that's in the blood. They said where the blood is. Many years ago, Dr. Nagel came to preach at a friend of mine's parish, and he had never really had any dealings with the man before, so he didn't know what he was getting into. And he said, I walked out of the sacristy, and he's sitting there like this. And I'm like, Dr. Nagel, are you all right? And Dr. Nagel's answer was, oh, I'm fine. I'm just making sure of the specificity of the locatedness of the gifts. The specificity of the locatedness of the gifts. Where can you find the blood that takes away the sin of the world? Where can you taste the Father's love? Where can you receive the salvation? Kimmerer. How many of you guys had Kimmerer as your textbook? We are growing so slim. Wow. Huh? That was your prof. Wow. See, when I went to seminary, of course, he was deceased. But his text still was the way that we learned how to preach. And he was very good about saying that you needed to always have your sermon anchored in the means of grace. That it needs to get there. And I think that's Nagel's specificity of the locatedness of the gifts. Kemmerer is just like, make sure that in the sermon, as part of your good news, you have a proclamation to the people of where it can be had and found and rejoiced in. Kemmerer had another thing that was very important. He basically said, you can't preach the gospel without the kerygma. It is necessary, but it is not sufficient. You have to have it in there. But in and of itself, that's not the gospel. So let's look at how the apostles, how did the apostles actually preach when they were preaching? Let's start with the first full blast sermon we get in the book of Acts, which is Acts 2. Turn there and see what we have. Acts 2. And let's pick up where, well, It's at least worthwhile to note that they thought they were drunk. And why? Why did they think they were drunk?
Speaking in different languages.
I think St. Seraphim of Sarov said, the Holy Spirit turns to joy everything he touches. And I think these men were so overflowing with joy that morning that the only possible explanation for their idiotically happy babbling would have to be that they'd been in the sauce. So it's fascinating to see how Peter deals with it. He stands up, verse 14, standing with the 11, he lifts his voice and he says, men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you. Give ear to my words. Wow, this is Peter, right? You know, I mean, come on, this is Peter that was hiding and that was denying. And now he is bold to stand there in front of these people and say, listen to my words, give ear to me. These people are not drunk as you suppose, since it's only the third hour of the day. I always found that to be an interesting little comment, as though maybe later in the day it would be a reasonable assumption. But he says, this is what was uttered through the prophet Joel. He goes to his text. And in the last days it shall be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons, your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men dreams. On my male servants and female servants in those days I will pour out my spirit and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in the heavens and signs on the earth below. Blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the day of the Lord comes, the great and magnificent day. And then this is what he's driving toward. And it will come to pass that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. A universal promise. And so he says, men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, stop. How many of you guys have heard the diagnostic that Wilkin uses on issues, etc.? Any of you? It's kind of interesting. I think it's I'm not entirely a fan of it, but I do appreciate this. He says, if you don't mention Jesus, there's a really good chance you're not preaching the gospel. And if you do mention Jesus, but he's not the doer of the verbs, then there's a really good chance that you're not preaching the gospel. Notice, after Joel is cited, he immediately goes to Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves know. This Jesus, delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. Now, if you pay really careful attention in Acts, when they move out of Jerusalem, they no longer talk like that. He doesn't say, when he's outside of Jerusalem, you killed him. Outside of Jerusalem, he says, they killed him. I know it preaches really well to lay, you did this. But in Peter's circumstance, he was laying it right there, actually, on the people who did. You killed him by the hands of lawless men, but God raised him up, loosening the pangs of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by it. David says concerning him, well, before we go on, what pieces of the kerygma do we have here? Jesus comes as the fulfillment of Old Testament prophecy. He comes from Nazareth. He comes as a wonder worker. He does stuff that there is put yourself in the boat with those men, right? You know, I mean, he's sleeping and they're bailing and he's sleeping. And finally, they're like, don't you care? Get up, do something. We're dying. And then he stands up and says, oh, stop that. Stop, cease. I mean, can you see them? They're exhausted. They're soaking wet. And they are backing as far away from him as they can. And they're saying, who is this? Who is this that can do this, that can say to the wind and the waves? And they listen, who is this? Peter says, it's only one answer to who it is. Can only be one answer. And you all know it. And you killed him anyway. how he lays it out there as part of the kerygma. So the wonder worker. You crucified, so there's the cross, killed by lawless men. God raised him from the dead, resurrection. Not possible for him to be held by it. A little further, more Old Testament text. David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken. So my heart is glad and my tongue rejoiced. My flesh also dwells in hope. For you will not abandon my soul to Hades or let your Holy One see corruption. You've made known to me the path of life. You make me full of gladness in your presence. So who's the prophet talking about? He's like, brothers, I'm telling you something you all know. David, he died. He was buried. His tomb is with us to this day. He saw corruption. But being a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with an oath that he would set one of his descendants on his throne, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of Christ, that he was not abandoned to Hades, and his flesh did not see corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that we are all witnesses. Just stop at that point. Jesus as the fulfillment of every prophecy in the Old Testament is an essential piece of the New Testament preaching. If you're going to be a New Testament preacher, you have to be saturated in the Old Testament Jesus. I don't think we've thought this way through as much as we should. I mean, just stop, think about this. Let me give you two examples out of the Old Testament. So Moses, he's born, condemned, the son of slaves. He's going to have to die. But he gets thrown in the water and drawn out as a prince. As Poirot would say, it gives one furiously to think. Kind of reminds us of another water where condemned slaves are tossed in and drawn out as members of the royal family. How about this one? This is even more weird. Jacob loves Esau and wants to give him the blessing. Of course, Rebecca hears and figures, no, that's not what God said. That's not how we're going to do this. Son, you listen to me. We're going to do this. We're going to dress you up. We're going to dress you up in your brother's clothes. And I'm going to present you to your blind father, who will smell the fragrance of his older son on you and deliver to you the blessing of the older son, while you, older son, end up receiving the curse, all that's left. Do you have a mother who dressed you up in your older brother's clothes and presented you to a father who was willfully blind that he might bestow upon you the older brother's inheritance and give you all the goodies? Yes. Yes, you have the church as your mother. Yeah. I think we need to get ourselves back into a way of seeing the Old Testament as so saturated with Christ that he is truly there at every juncture. I mean, if Paul can find him in a rock moving around, there are lots more places that are easier than that. So, he goes further. David did not ascend to the heavens, but he says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. So then verse 36, let all the house of Israel then know for certain, God has made him, both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. And when the people hear it, they begin to freak out. What should we do? Peter's response, what does he say? Repent and be baptized, every one of you, and all those sins will be forgiven, all of you. And you will receive the gift of the Spirit. That promise is for you, and it's for your kids, and it's for all who are far off, for everyone whom the Lord God calls to himself. The preaching wasn't good news until he had anchored it in where they could receive the gifts that he was proclaiming by promise. The Jesus who fulfills the Old Testament by suffering, dying, rising again in glory, who then gives the gift of the Spirit, this Jesus, who comes to his people to give them his very own sonship. Let's flip over to chapter Acts 3. What time are we at?
You're good.
A question or comment?
Well, yeah. It just struck me the way you took us through that. The way he ends goes back to the initial text from Joel, doesn't he?
Yes, he does.
The promise is for you and your children. The Spirit is poured out on them. It's not just the apostles.
Right, right. The promise is for you. And of course, think about it. The apostles got the pyrotechnic display early in the day, but at the end of the day, 3,000 people got the Spirit in the normal, usual way that we get him. They got in the water with Jesus, and there the Spirit is dumped out upon them. Yeah, powerful. So in Acts 3, you have another sermon from Peter, and this time Peter he's like, verse 12, men of Israel, why are you staring at us? As though we had the power to make that lame guy walk. Bless you. He says, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, that is saying the God of the Old Testament, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus. Unpack that pais for me. Do you remember the double way that goes? Pais. Son and servant. I mean, both together. You can't cut the son out of the servant there. They run together. He glorified his son servant Jesus, whom you delivered over and denied in the presence of Pilate. Part of the kerygma is anchoring that this is no myth. This is history. It happened at a specific time under a specific Roman governor. And when he had decided, you denied him when he decided to release him. But what the one you denied was the holy and the righteous one, and you asked instead for a murderer to be given to you. You know the whole joy of Bar Abbas. Bar Abbas, son of a father, yes, son of Father Adam. Luther says Adam is the greatest murderer in the history of the race. So we all die in him. But Jesus, the true son of the Father, given in exchange so the other one gets off scot-free. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. And we're witnesses of this. And his name, faith in his name, is what this made this man strong, whom you see and know. The faith that's through Jesus has given this man this perfect health in the presence of you all. And I know you acted ignorantly, as did your rulers. But what God foretold by the mouth of his prophets that the Christ would suffer, that's what he fulfilled. So repent, turn again, that your sins may be blotted out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord, that he may send the Christ appointed for you, Jesus, whom heaven must receive until the time for restoring all the things which God spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets long ago. Moses said, the Lord God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brothers. You shall listen to him and whatever he tells you. And it shall be that everyone who does not listen to him, he shall be destroyed from the people. And all the prophets have spoken, from Samuel and those who came after him. They also proclaim these days. You're the sons of the prophets and of the covenant that God made with your father, saying to Abraham, in your offspring shall all the families of the earth be blessed. God, having raised up his servant, sent him first to you to bless you by turning every one of you from your wickedness. See, the Father forgive of the cross. Have you ever wondered, I mean, those judgment parables Jesus gives in Holy Week about what he'll do to those wretches who throw the son out of the vineyard and say the vineyard's theirs? And what does he do? He sends instead an embassy back and says, it's okay, it's all part of my plan. I love you, I forgive you. Repent, rejoice. I got forgiveness for you right here in Jesus. All right, are we still good time-wise? Okay. I want us to turn to a different kind of a preaching. Well, we could have a lot of fun in Stephen's speech, because he really doesn't let the whole, I mean, he does the whole history of Israel. But we're going to let that go. And we're going to move to a preaching that happened in Cornelius' house. You remember the vision and how Peter just wasn't getting it. Three times God says, rise, kill, and eat. Three times he says, hey, nothing kosher, unkosher has ever passed these lips. I ain't doing this. And God's saying, don't you call unclean what I've cleansed. And he's saying, what does this mean? I mean, this is Peter who heard Jesus say, go and preach the gospel to all nations. preach the gospel to the whole creation. And they're still struggling, trying to understand, well, surely that means that everybody can become a Jew and be saved, right? And Jesus is about to just blow that out the water. So Peter begins to get it. Look at verse 34 of Acts chapter 10. Verse 34. What's particularly interesting about this section is this sermon of Peter's is the outline to the book of Mark. And, of course, according to tradition, what is the book of Mark? Peter's preaching in Rome, right? It's striking in its parallelism. So Peter opened his mouth and he said, okay, now I get it. God shows no partiality. In every nation, anyone who fears him and does what's right is acceptable to him. As for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace through Jesus Christ, he is the Lord of all. You yourselves know what happened throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee, after the baptism John proclaimed, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. Remember, in Mark's gospel, the way the whole thing unfolds, Jesus coming back from that water, from his baptism and from his time in the wilderness, he basically is recapitulating Israel's history. And he's coming into the Holy Land to kick demonic butt. 10 minutes? Thank you. He's coming to kick demonic butt. He goes after the demons right away as the one who will not let Satan have his hold on the lives of men. He goes after him. So he picks that up right away. How he went about doing good. And we are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. Now notice how he puts it here. What's he say? They put him to death. He doesn't say you put him to death. He says they put him to death. And how did they put him to death? By hanging on a tree. Again, the cross. Even if you don't say the word cross, it's central. Why would you say hanging on a tree? What would that evoke if you're a Jew? I mean, Cornelius wasn't, but what would that evoke? Curse. Cursed. Damned. Hanging on a tree. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. But God raised him on the third day and made him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who had been chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. There's a new piece of the kerygma. We've not had this before. That the people he appeared to after the resurrection were people that he ate with. Go through and check it out in the Gospels. Jesus shows up and there's almost always chow going on. And if there isn't, he provides it. You might think about, you know how in Luke 24, how that just totally flows into the divine service, right? I mean, he opens the scriptures, explains to them how the Christ needed to suffer and die and be raised from the dead, and then they finally recognize who he is as he takes, blesses, breaks the bread. I don't know how you picture it. I always picture it right here in front of his face as he's saying the berachah, and he breaks it. And then boom, they go, woo-hoo! And he's gone, and they're spread. And did they eat it? You better believe they ate it as they were running back to tell the others. We've seen him. He really has been raised. So they ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. What's the eating and drinking, by the way, show too? True body, right? This is not a phantom. My first parish, talk about biblical ignorance. My first parish in North Carolina, I remember getting into such a fight with Ruby Hoft. She's like, oh, absolutely, it is not. He was not raised with a real body. And I'm like, Ruby, it was a real body. She goes, no, because you can't take a real body through a door. And I said, you can't tell him what he can do with his body. He can do many things with his body that are beyond you. I said, but it was a real body, and he invited people to touch it, and he ate. And she goes, well, that couldn't have been real because he went through a door. I have no idea how what the ending of that story was. She was a member of the church as long as I was there, but I don't think I ever persuaded her. What do you do? He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he's the one appointed by God to be judge of the living and the dead. Here's another new piece to the kerygma you've not heard yet. That at the end of days, you're going to stand, not before God the Father, with Jesus pleading for you. You're going to be standing before Jesus Christ. He is the judge. All judgment has been handed over to the Son. All of it. And so you will give an account to him. And as St. Paul would say, you will receive what you did in the body, whether good or evil. Ouch. Lutherans really need to find a place for teaching about the judgment again in our preaching. How something that was so essential in the kerygma came to just disappear from our preaching is beyond me. And he commanded us to preach to the people, to testify he's the one appointed by God to judge the living and the dead. But what's the final word? What do all the prophets say about him? To him, all the prophets bear witness that... How many? Everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. And when they tell you, you Lutherans think too much about forgiveness and that it always comes down to that, I just want to say, have you checked out how the apostles preached? Every sermon we've looked at so far has ended with forgiveness, that this is what God has done and gives to you. And of course, it's one of those glorious moments as Peter's preaching. What happens? The Spirit falls on everybody who's listening to the word. Want to get how that works? Okay, right? Where the word is preached, there the Spirit comes. And then Peter's like, what are we supposed to do? We can't not baptize them now. I mean, God blew it. He gave them the Holy Spirit already. He didn't wait. Now what are we supposed to do? I guess they're members of the church full without being circumcised. All right, we're going to stop at that point, having looked at the kerygma. When I said it's not sufficient unless it drives to the locatedness and to forgiveness, right? Without forgiveness, we still haven't preached news that is truly, truly good. Yeah, Dr. Stockwish. Yes,
now,
here he is.
He judges them by forgiving them and pouring out the Spirit upon them. Or those who reject him, I mean, they're condemned by their own rejection.
Yeah.
He does not believe in me, he's already judged, and it's John.
I do you remember in at the end of the last battle when they come in before Aslan, you either run to him in joy or you shrink from him in shame and sorrow into the shadow. Hebrews is where Lewis got the idea from, right? You know, we are not of those who shrink back, but of those who run to meet him. So when we come to the judgment, the one who will be doing the judging is the one who has the nail scars in his hands. And that should fill us with great comfort and joy. I don't think it means that there's not sometimes in the judgment an ouch as well as an awe. 1 Corinthians 3 is actually very clear that it's possible if you did not build on the foundation. Well, I describe it like this. Everything in our life that's not love is going to be burned up. All of it burned up. And on that day, you're going to be saying, burn, baby, burn. Get rid of it. I want it out of my life for good. I never want to see it again. So it's possible, Paul says, to experience loss as through fire and yet still to be saved. And most Lutherans say, hey, as long as I'm saved, that's really all I care about. Just get me into the kingdom. But Paul is concerned in, you know, with the teaching about the reward for good works, which will be part of the judgment. And I know that's a part of our dogmatic tradition, but again, whenever I've brought it up and taught it in Bible class, what do the people always say? Pastor, we never heard that. We have an obligation to teach the whole counsel of God, and that's part of what the Word of God does teach, no matter how uncomfortable it makes you. The cool thing is when we see it the way that, like Lewis described it, on that day, I'm not going to be sitting there going, oh man, Rick is shining in more light and glory than I got. You know, you're going to be saying, oh, look at him shine. Thanks be to God. And you're not going to be looking at you. You're going to be looking at all the others and enjoying them. And so it won't be a matter of jealousy or fear on that day. Yeah. When we preach him, the day of judgment is here.
And so, to go back to your original kind of questions, I would agree there's a wrap. You know, people don't know their Bible, they don't know their stories. But I think we also don't necessarily know the character of the word as we preach it, that it isn't just remembering or information, but that the word itself is a means of grace that is confronting people with Christ.
Luther's great word, a tatwort. A word that does what it says, a tatwort. It makes things happen. I always use the example, the contrary example of, if I told my son, David, take out the trash, sometimes it happened and sometimes it didn't. My word did not have the power to make it happen. But when Christ says, your sins are forgiven, they're gone, period. All right, we have a lot. Yeah, okay, go ahead. All right,
last question,
okay.
I'm wondering comment. If you could comment on whether you think it would be advisable or inadvisable or necessary or unnecessary to import the vicarious satisfaction if you were preaching on Peter's preaching to Cornelius, for example.
Yeah, I will tell you flat out, I don't think that vicarious satisfaction is the only way that the good news comes to us.
Right, that's...
I mean, that Christ's blood has forgiven the sins of the world. Well, let me close with a quote from Krauth. Krauth says, that explanation which seeks to explain the atonement is rotten at its core. We proclaim what the blood of Christ does. We get our noses out of how the blood of Christ does it. And, you know, the classic instance of this, I think, is look at 555 and 556. 555 in the hymnal is most people's favorite Reformation hymn, Spiratus, right? Classic vicarious satisfaction. The doom which over us impended, you know. Against that, look at the picture of God the Father in Luther's hymn. There is no vicarious satisfaction in Luther's hymn. Christ comes along, sent from the Father out of love to come alongside of you and pound on the enemies who would destroy you. In fact, Luther's own preaching tended not to go to vicarious satisfaction as much as most Lutheran preaching today. He was much more content to proclaim Christus Victor. But the thing is, they're all there in Scripture. We proclaim all that God gives us. Great. Thank you. Excellent question. Excellent. More on all that later. Thank you.